So good morning.
Everyone. Good morning, everyone.
My name is Franz from Incura. Incura is a specialist for data-driven BI, basically on customer-centric focus. Their core business for us is supporting multi-channel retailers, but we're also supporting customers in the area of digital transformation. We are the data specialists. We're working a lot with the partners, like CrossEngage. With CrossEngage, we play the role of the data integrator. Or with Experify, they are the business consultants, and they help together with the client to change the business. Maybe Oliver, you'll say a bit about your company.
Yes, so my name is Oliver Wolf. I'm a co-founder of Experify. As Franz said, we have a partnership together, and we develop strategies for marketing. I'm now here for my partner and co-founder, Roland Brettschneider, who's more the data guy and more experienced in this topic. Anyway, I'm coming more from the marketing side, and I will use this presentation to tell you more from a perspective from a CMO or a head of marketing, why this is what we are doing is important and how you can benefit from the product we show you later on.
Yeah. So if you have questions in between, just like jump in. We are here for you. If you have any questions, then we try to handle them right away. If it gets too much that we are losing time for a presentation, then maybe we have to push it back. But feel free to jump in anytime.
Exactly. So I will give you a quick overview. So what you can see now on the screen is it's not so new, but it's still what I was struggling the most in my different roles as interim CMO at different companies, that you always have the same goals. You have to increase your sales. You have to handle your customer satisfaction. You have to get a really holistic, omnichannel view, and you have to spend your money as efficient as possible. And in the best case, you have to improve this every month and every year. And normally, in this role, you're facing with a lot of challenges. There are a lot of internal challenges, like you can see here that you have problems with the data, that we have the data in different silos, that the data quality is maybe not the quality how you can handle it best, and it's also sometimes a problem to understand the different data points. On the other hand, it's also the same like that the last years ongoing. So data privacy regulations, which gets harder every year. We have GDPR, we have different things coming up. We don't even know yet fully and how and 100% how to deal with all this GDPR requirements. And we have the problem, like also the colleagues from Galeria Kaufhof told you, you have so many touch points and so on, and it gets always much harder to understand what the customer wants and what the customer does.
Yep. So I'm happy that you have shown up. I didn't expect lots of people because I think we selected a stupid title because 370 degrees obviously does not exist. Yeah. 360 degrees also does not exist, in my opinion. It's just impossible, at least outside China, to know everything that your customers are doing. It's just not possible. I would say, good morning. It's one of our partners. So, if you're like a traditional company and you have the offline sales, you have the online sales, and you're not fully integrated, maybe you're around 160 degrees. You've seen maybe a bit less than half of it. Then you do the channel integration, maybe you get like to 260 degrees. And with the different approaches, you can increase the coverage of the customer view and the market view. And we want to show you like three approaches that you can combine to improve from maybe where you are today and increase the coverage of the customers and get more competitive in a market to become more relevant to the customers and to become also more competitive against the big players. And the big players, they have the scale to do a lot of stuff, to see a lot from their customers, to see a lot of the market trends. And the smaller ones, they sometimes struggling, but there's different options to improve the situation. So basically the approach is one, what we call first party data, that's the data that you have inside your organization, inside your department. That's the data that you can access and then you can integrate into the typical BI approach. That's a data warehouse, that's a BI platform, that's a MIS, however you call it, but that's what people do for many, many years. The challenge in the last years have to been to integrate the different channels and to have this 360-degree customer view, which is not 360, but to have an integrated view across your customer base and your contact and order channels, basically. Then we want to show you an approach, what we call here second-party data. This would be like you have data inside your larger organization, if you have a corporate group, or if you have, like, for example, different shops with different legal entities, where you have limitations from the legal side and data privacy side to combine the data, even if it's inside the bigger area of your organization, of your company. That's what we call here with the trust center. So the trust center approach helps you to combine this data in a way which is compliant with data regulation and internal policies, company policies. And the third one, this is also something that is quite new for us, what we call third-party data, is to combine data from different companies on a detail level. So to have really like a cluster of different companies, and the aim is to increase the reach and to increase the understanding of the market together to help each other against the strong big players. So this is basically the three blocks we want to show. And the idea is to go from a situation where you still have non-integrated data, where you have some data silos, to go into an integrated view, to have two different approaches to add data to what you normally do to enhance your view and your customer reach and to get a better understanding of your customers. Yeah. So the first block is basically what you know already. It's traditional BI. We are providing traditional BI. I think we're doing a few things maybe a bit differently. One of the main things that we're working on is what we call the customer journey, because beside the master data, the customer behavior is one of the main drivers for understanding customers and also making relevant offers. I mean, like we have seen before, segmentation, dynamic segmentation is mostly driven by behavior. And then you need to understand what kind of precision you can get, what is the requirement for data quality, and what kind of activities you can derive from these things. So I have a few screenshots because we want to show like the brand, what we do. The BI platform basically is covering the typical things of a data warehouse. For some clients, we are a complete data warehouse. For others, we have more the role of a marketing data mart. Normally, we start with marketing, so traffic acquisition, marketing performance optimization, then we go to CRM, customer profiling, customer personas, CRM campaigns. Then the third partners is either controlling or product management. Product management is interested in our platform because we can also show product interest, not only product sales, and map it to conversion and profit figures. And then we have open platform that can be customized, so we can do all the data science stuff, we can add new data sources. It's really like a completely scalable data warehouse. But we come with a pre-configured platform. It's aimed at multi-channel merchants, basically. The idea is a bit like SAP. So you have a standard product that can be configured and extended, but you start very fast and very quickly on a level, on the next level of your experience. So the typical customers we're working for, they have data warehouses, they have data marts, they are struggling a bit with data integration, and they are also aiming to get more data, integrated data on the detail levels to have more efficient and more effective campaigns at the end of the day. So, how do we try to get like customer understanding out of the data? For the stuff that we're showing today, the first one is channel and device integration to get the complete picture of the customer. We need common data to, so a common data representation to scale up to new channels, to new source systems, to new processes. So everything we do, we have one contact history. And if it's stores, if it's TV, if it's online marketing, if it's mobile, it's everything is in the same contact table. Everything is in the same marketing calendar table. And the user journey is one single user journey, and we model all the different channels, all the different contact channels. So this is really, really important for us that we can scale and that we can act in an agile way for changing environments. And in marketing, you always want to try new marketing partners. You get a new marketing partner, we plug in the connector, and then you see it in the report. So this is really, really essential if you want to move forward in a changing environment. Then cross-channel, cross-device consolidation, and then the journey and the attribution. This is the main parts I want to show today. We're also outside on the booth, so feel free to come around and ask the colleagues, not me, ask the colleagues, for everything which is interesting for you. So when we say we want to be fast, what we do normally, if you have customers interested in an offer, we do a trial phase. It's 8 weeks, we do 4 weeks setup, we do 4 weeks trial with the customer data. And to be this fast, we have a lot of connectors. They're connecting to the outside world. Inside, we have the standard model. And we can load very, very quickly the customer data and set up the trial phase. Also, if you get new campaign partners, if you get new marketing partners, if you change your email system, we can react really, really quickly in a transparent way. So we sometimes do with our clients benchmarks across different approaches. So what is the critical success factor if you want to model customer journeys? And I mean, it's really obvious, you need backend data. If you want to have good customer journey information, you need to combine channel data with backend data. And we did a benchmark with one of the big Berlin-based journey consulting companies and compared the data based on traffic data and based on combined data. And what we have found is that if you just go on traffic data, you have a lot of journeys with just single contacts. So people come and buy. This looks good, but it's just not true. Yeah? And then you have not so many ongoing customer journeys. This looks a bit like your customer base is not very active. If you combine it then with the backend data and you have more information on how to consolidate users and cookies and call center calls and everything in your customer journey, then suddenly you see you have much more ongoing journeys. You get more contacts. You see that people first look at products before they buy. That's really a surprise. Huh? They're not just coming and buying. They look at different products and then they buy something. This makes much more sense. Huh? I mean, it's a no-brainer, but you can see it in the data if you really try it on different approaches from journey modeling. So one of the key messages I hope you take away is the channel integration is the critical thing if we believe it's a critical thing if you model customer behavior and journeys. It's more important than attribution logic, but I come back to this. So what is our experience or our recommendations in terms of journey modeling? So you can do it in many different ways. I don't want to go into the details, but go down to the lowest level. So you need to be able to measure everything on the lowest level, otherwise you're not actionable afterwards. Yeah? You need to see which newsletters, which keywords, which whatever is really working in, with a good performance, bad performance, that you can start optimizing that stuff. If you look at performance, you can go for the core, but it's stupid if you are in certain businesses. If you're a retailer and you have a return rate of like 20-30% or more, then the core just doesn't make sense. So you have to select your success metric, which is based on your business model, and optimize based on this. This might mean you really need to go to the backend data. You really need to map it to the lowest level, so to each contact. Otherwise, your performance metrics will be really, really off, and you're optimizing not in the right directions. Make sure, if you do attribution, that your figures add up. So if you take all the channels and you sum up the revenue, it should match the controlling figures. Yeah? This would be nice. It's not often that I can see that, but this is really, really critical. If the totals don't add up, if you just take the marketing partner reports, you get normally like 20% more revenue than from controlling people. This looks nice, but it just doesn't exist, the 20%. For this, also you need the backend data to validate. One example is if you go for web tracking tools, that can be anything, including Google Analytics, they're roughly losing 10% of clicks because of technology. That also means they're losing 10% of revenue. But you need to include it in the journeys to have a proper view of your performance. Yeah? Then, from our opinion, the structure of the journeys and the attribution is much more relevant than the attribution calculation in terms of like contact weights or contact revenue that you attribute to a single click, because you have the decision funnel, and if you cannot like integrate the acquisition channels with the conversion channels, if you can't split new customers with existing customers work completely different than new customer acquisition. If you put that in one single acquisition, you get a mix of nothing. Yeah? So you need to really think about the business logic of your attribution. And this stuff can be done. Yeah? What we always do is split new customers from existing customers. They're just different. New customers, you want to optimize for acquisition. Existing customers, you want to optimize for conversion. That means different channels have played different roles. And then the funny thing with the attribution and the journeys is always we have time, but we have it twice. You have the click time, you have the conversion time, and this becomes really interesting when you come from a last click environment where these things are the same. And this is quite demanding also to understand and how to act on the two different ways and two different dimensions of time. Yeah. I make it quick. We also do with all the data that we have profile reports. You can push in your segmentations and your scorings that you want. You get like 10-page profiles out of it. This is like one of the benefits of integrated BI, that you can analyze and create results from your detailed data very easily and very quickly. Yeah. So BI is a lot, many, many things more. Just if you look in the direction of the integrated customer views, our key takeaways from the last years of working with the platform is do everything on the lowest level, stay operational, yeah? That you can put stuff into action. You need to have the email address, you need to have the cookie, you need to have the product ID, you need to have it always on the lowest level to stay actionable. Marketing cost, put the cost where it comes from. So marketing cost, putting it to the buyers is nice, but that's not reality. 90% of marketing cost is not created by the buyers. It's created by the non-buyers. And non-buyers are customers who are not buying right now, and it's prospects. So then good data quality, good customer view for us is always means include channel data with backend data. Always aim for profit metrics and not only for gross revenue, whatever you're looking at. Really go for the proper success metrics. Try to add all the relevant context channels. This is one of our main findings. If you're missing out like call center and then you're investing a lot in the attribution curve, the net effect will be lower than if you add the channel and make a simpler attribution curve. Because you just need to get all the touch points of the customers. User journeys is obviously used for marketing performance, but also use it for CRM, use it for product management. There's not only a marketing journey, there's also a product journey. So really make use of customer behavior in every way that you're looking at your business. And attribution is something that you have to do properly. If you do it halfway, then probably you put a lot of effort and gain not a lot of results for this. So this is basically, we have the customer-centric approach. We try to use this in the different areas of acquisition, of CRM, product management, controlling, and also with the approach of the connectors, we can scale very fast and drive very fast. If you're interested, we are outside. Normally what we do for people who are interested, you have the trial phase. The trial phase is just like taking your data. We need all the contracts in place, obviously. But this eight-week approach to validate these ideas and the difference that could make to your organization in 8 weeks. You don't buy licenses, you don't buy data center. This is just like what we do in a trial phase. So if you're interested, then feel free. And then now, Oliver.
So yes, Franz already mentioned it in his slide two, where we presented the Trust Center, which is for us the next step after integrating all the data into the BI. So the Trust Center is a cooperation between our two companies where we partner up with companies and provide them a holistic marketing view, where we get all of this data, which gets first in the BI, we put it to the trust center, and we make it GDPR conform. Because this is maybe what I experienced in the last year as VP Marketing PaysafeCard the most. We have a lot of data, we have a lot of data in different silos, but I'm not allowed to use it anymore. And I'm facing everyday challenges with GDPR officers to tell me, you can't use this data anymore, you have to anonymize it, you have to, it's not only names, it's not only email addresses, there is more and more data you can't use, and it doesn't help that you make hashes out of it, so it has to be a one way. So we put data into the trust center, and we make sure that this data cannot be put back so that you come back to the person, because otherwise you will get a problem in the future. And as we all know, we got ready in our different companies to be GDPR conform, but we don't know what's coming next and what are the next big steps, because there have not many had not many been audits on companies yet, and not many things where we know how, where we improve. And this is why we tried to be as GDPR conform as possible now, so that you are on the safe side if you partner up. And Trust Center is a new product which we are now created for one of the biggest insurance companies in Europe, and what we can also provide for different companies.
Yeah, maybe if I just jump in, what is our target market? So banks and insurance is obvious because of the regulations, the stronger regulations than normal. Then second market is companies that have separate legal entities inside, like different shops, different brands, and they want to combine the data. And the third market that we are working with currently is marketing agencies, where customers want to give the agencies more information that they can do better optimization across the channels, so multi-channel marketing mix optimization. But the customers want to control the level and of detail that the agencies get, and also the make sure that they get the anonymized data, so that this data interchange with the service providers is really in an organized way. I think that's currently the three main markets.
Yeah, so this this customer journey is what Franz mentioned, is what is probably not so new for many of you. So you have so many different touch points, and most of the companies we worked for, they are very good at the top part. So it got easier with the different analytics tools to get all these online touch points. But there are a lot of companies who have a lot of offline touch points. If it's a call center, or if it's a point of sale, or if it's print or TV, we are struggling to get this data in, and especially to get this data in a high data quality and to work with it. And this is what we are doing to make sure that this is a high data quality, that we can match it with each other, and then the big USB that we can also use this data for our attribution model and to see how it really works. Because otherwise, if you just look on the top line here, you have all your online connection points, but you may be missing the one point who brings it all together. And what I have seen in different analyses in the companies, when you also go to old stuff like MPS service and so on, sometimes you get insights and you're missing the one point, the one touch point which leads to your sale very often. And this is what we are trying to fix here. The challenges, we are running out of time, so I go through it very quickly. So what I said, personal data, the interpretation gets wider. So it's not only name anymore, it's way more at the moment. You have to be way more secure in how you store your data and how you work with your data. And it's not only how you store your data, it's also on how this data goes within the process. It gets more difficult to not only make the data not usable for the company anymore, you also have, like, from a legal perspective, you have to sometimes have it as third parties, so that not all the data is within your company anymore, and that you are allowed to, as I said before, that you bring it back to the customer in the end. Most important of all, we have to build like a system which is flexible, because it's GDPR, it's private security, there's so many cybersecurity, there are so many things coming up in the next week, so We took hard care to really make this this tool as flexible as possible, so that we can really react to the environment and what is happening on regulatory reasons, on marketing reasons out there. And as we all know, marketing changes very quickly. So what can the Trust Center provide for you? We integrate all of your data in the best data quality, which is then going to the BI and then back to the Trust Center. We are building patterns, we are building like lookalikes, we are building click paths and customer journeys, where you then, as a responsible for marketing, can really make the best possible decision on which channels to use and which data you use and where to invest and which channels are probably the one not really leading to customer satisfaction, and really trying to provide the whole holistic customer view. And yes, this in a very rapid way. I don't know if you showed it on the last slide, so it's within 8 weeks from your side, and then so we can really be quick in this to make it happen. And this is more the data slide, where I don't want to go in detail now. As I said, we are running out of time, but this is the key factors of the Trust Center, which we then can discuss afterwards in one-on-one, so we will be around. And also in CUDA has an exhibition stand out there where we can answer all your questions, if this is probably a solution which fits in your company. Last slide on the Trust Center, this is just a short glimpse on how it works. So we have all this online front-end data, we have the BI bringing it into the Trust Center, which is not within your company. There all the magic happens, which I explain in detail in a one-to-one, and then you can bring it back to your BI, or you can bring it back to external data platforms so that you can work with it, create reports, and make your decisions.
Yeah, so that's the next step for us, to enhance the customer view and get more information than you have on your single legal entity. The data warehouse BI and the Trust Center is not really new stuff. This exists for many years. We try to do it in a bit different way. Our BI is strictly user-centric. The Trust Center completely integrates with that. The third one, what we call the BI data space, is a bit new. It's not a new idea. There is the International Data Space Initiative, from also from the European Union and the Fraunhofer. This is basically coming from manufacturing side, where they want, where different companies want to integrate data and to optimize processes, stuff like this. We take this idea, bring it to the marketing and multi-channel environment, and the idea is to increase the power and the precision of the customer management for single companies by sharing and exchanging data in a controlled and compliant way. So basically, the idea of this chart here is, you have the big players, and Amazon knows everyone in Europe. They know everyone. If you're a normal retailer, you can't directly compete against them in a normal business. They're just too small to have the same scale of the business. And the idea is that you connect in a cluster with other companies to enhance your reach, see more of your clients, see more of your markets, have better benchmarking KPIs, and become more effective and more efficient in your marketing and customer management activities. So the first step is enhance the reach on the market, first on an analytical way, get a deeper customer understanding by seeing more what people do. It's not seeing only more people, but also see more what single persons do, because this is always on single persons. That's why it's different to market research. This is not a market research approach. It's sharing data on a user level for prospects and customers. That's the difference. And then getting this filtering first on the customers which belongs to your business. So looking at customers who are relevant for your business, and then getting this knowledge and bringing that back to your own business. The next step will be to offer marketing services, campaign services, audience, based on this platform. So, this approach is basically from the idea of the International Data Space. They have a lot of architecture. One of the key points is data integration. You have the trusted partners that make sure that you handle all the processes and all the data in the right way. And we have a defined status of exchange, connecting to the clusters. So if you want to share data with other companies, this is two-way double opt-in, let's call it. So you can apply to join a cluster, and then in the cluster, each company can confirm that you can connect with them. You can always reject the connection, and you don't get the company names. You get like metadata about the company. So everything is like private, and you still have a defined way of connecting data and deriving KPIs for your own business for this, for customer understanding, for benchmarking, and for deriving like product affinities, customer activity for your own treatments. Yeah. So this is still quite new.
I think we get kicked off the stage.
We get kicked off. Okay. So we have.
Sign that we're running out of time. So we have a couple of minutes for some questions. Do you have questions?
All right. So about attribution, how do you handle the offline stuff? How do you model that, basically?
Yeah. So offline is a bunch of different things. You have like store visits. You have like, if you count TV as offline, you have out of home, you have print and catalog stuff, and each one has different quality of how it behaves. And the simple answer to the question is through processes and services. So if you have like print, you have like the codes, the catalog suffix, prefix. TV, we do with probabilistic uplift modeling, but on single models out of, if you go to the stores, that depends. If you have like customer cards, if you're selling low price or high price stuff, so if you have warranty, if you have invoices with named names, so this always depends. But one of the jobs from us is to talk with our clients how to configure processes, how to define services to get better in this area. So it's never about being perfect, it's how to do it more clever to get better. And then the architecture is built that we always like update in real time if you get a new information on people. But it's about getting better. It's not about being perfect.
More questions? We have some more time left. No. So thanks very much, Franz and Oliver, for a very interesting and content-rich talk. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks.